Hey lovelies, good afternoon, good morning, good evening. You are welcome to my channel. Thank you so much for clicking. As always, I really appreciate it. And if this is the first time you're clicking on any video on YouTube and see my face, hello, my name is Adela and I am the sole administrator of this channel. I'd appreciate if you will click on the like button, subscribe and stay with me. Click on the notification bell so that anytime I upload another video, you're going to be among the first to know. I happen to be in a very, very good mood this evening and I want to do a story time for you. It has been on my mind for a while anyway that I should come and tell the story, and it's a sequel to one of my earliest videos. If you look at that video, you're going to laugh, but don't laugh too much. The title of that video is it has to do with marrying somebody for his potential, right? While I was making that video, it was resonating with me. I was talking like it was just remaining small for me to be inserting my name inside. Don't marry people for their potential. So this story I'm going to tell you is about the potential. I think I've met many potentials, you know, people who just came and they wanted you to marry them and they are brokers or they are nonsensical selves, you know, just date them because they believe that they have a bright future and all whatnot. In that video, I talk about what I think people need to do in order to know the kind of potential to marry or not to marry. If you have not watched it, link in the description box. I'd appreciate it if you will go and watch it, then you continue watching this one again. And this story I'm going to tell you now also explains the reason why I have this aversion that I have for pastors throughout my dating life. I never dated any pastor because of the impression that this guy made on me. Okay, back then I was in my mid-20s. And I think my mid-20s, they call it the roaring 20s for a reason, because mine was really the roaring 20s. Like, as in, oh my God, I had such fun in my 20s. It was like men were falling over themselves to do things for me. I had them coming from left, right, and center. At the point, I was like, am I the most beautiful woman in the world or what's meaning? You know, that kind of thing. What is it about me? I had people, men, falling over themselves to marry me, to buy stuff for me, to pay for stuff for me, to do things for me. I mean, I could take my pick of any man in the world. But I look back now and I think I was naive, right? Because, yeah, I was naive. Because then I used to be like, I cannot date anybody. I never even took money from men because I didn't want them to think I am much realistic and all whatnot. That kind of thing. But now, if you try, I don't see how I finish. If you try that thing near me, eh? Take me to a shopping mall and tell me to pick whatever I want. You are dead meat. I will literally pack everything in that supermarket. But that's by the way. So this man came to me. One day I was just walking. I had come back from school. So I was walking home and he saw me. And you know when a guy is love struck, you will know. Back then I noticed that he couldn't stop looking at me. He was just following me about with his eye. I was like, when the Maya fight, what? But I didn't really like him. Considered him a nuisance, but he was walking. He just followed me to my house, so he knew my house. I couldn't lie about where I live. Back then I had a lot of lies I used to tell men. I would lie about my phone number, I would lie about where I live, I would lie about my name and all whatnot, things that now I consider childish, you understand. So but that one knew my house, so he was always coming to my house or whatnot. So he wanted to date me, he wanted to love me, he wanted to marry me, he wanted me and him to build a life together and all whatnot. Meanwhile, he was squatting in his friend's house. And so he was always coming around my house, constituting himself into a nuisance. And he was a pastor of one of these big churches in Nigeria. But according to his story, he's no longer working in that church because he had irreconcilable differences with the senior pastor of one of the churches. And I think even though I was naive then, I knew that people should be able to submit themselves to higher authority. So what do you mean by you have irreconcilable differences with your pastor and you've left to go and form your own church? Anyways, so long and short, he was always coming to my house. Always, it got to a point, he was literally stalking me. He knew when I was going to come back from school. and all whatnot. I told the children on the streets, you know, I would take a longer route to come home so that he's not going to see me from the point where he usually waits for me. And then sometimes I think he will guess that I'm at home, or I don't really know. So what I did was I told children in my streets, in fact, I promised them 10 naira then. I said, if you see this man coming, you have a responsibility to come. The first person to run to the house and come and tell me, should, I'm going to give the person 10 naira. And so that was it then. For a while, I couldn't get away with that kind of thing for long now. One day, he will always come and catch me at home one day. Because I was this kind of person who liked to stay at home. I want to read a book. I want to listen, watch a movie or something like that. But he's going to come and be talking. So we were like that for a very long time, until one day I just decided, okay, no problem. Let me just give this guy audience. Let me hear what he's going to say so that I can tell him the no finally, because I have judged him based on his looks, which was that he's always looking very, very shabby. He talks too much and he's always singing. How is singing supposed to impress me, for crying out loud? You know all these songs that white people sing? I think they call it orchestras. I don't know if it's orchestra. They would oh, that kind of song. He was always doing it in my house. So I considered him a composite jerk, and I didn't want to have anything to do with him. But I just felt, okay, let me give him a chance. Let me sit down with him. Let's have a conversation one-on-one so that he can pitch anything he wants to say, so that I will look at him in his eye and say, brother, you can be going. Sorry, I don't buy into your vision. Okay, so the day we decided that we were going to do it, Gaima was even too broke. And you guys know that I didn't really like broke men back then. I had men who had money all over who would come and sit down and be dealing with a broke man. So instead of him to say, let's go somewhere that we can even have drinks, no, we just went to one place like that, sat down on that tree. That's where he wanted to propose or to make his case. Oh, no problem. Like, who am I to say that he's not going to ever become anything in his life? So we went under the tree and he began to tell me all sorts of stories, which were basically nonsense. Story number one, he has been dating one lady for a very, very long time. He dated her, and as a matter of fact, they were living together for about 10 years. So around the place where he lives, people thought he was married to that particular lady. And so, why don't you want to marry her now? Why is it me of all people? Why is it me you see now and you want to marry me within a few months' time? He said, it's because one, the lady, as they went on in the relationship, she developed fibroid. And so therefore, this popular misconception, I believe it's a misconception anyway, that if somebody has had fibroid, the person is going to have difficulties having children. And he wants to have children normally, therefore he cannot marry her again. So in my mind, I was like, man, this guy is very wicked. So it's me now here. Me, you want to marry me because of my uterus, right? Because you think I am in my 20s, therefore I'm not going to have conception issues. But you wasted this lady's time. While you were with her for 10 years, where were the babies? Was she on contraceptives or what? What happened that she didn't have any children for you? But the thing is that when you are living with her, you have chased away other suitors, right? He had chased away other suitors for her. And then now he wants to dump her after 10 years because of fibroid. What gives me the impression that me, when I develop my own fibroid or something else happened to me, I'm not going to get that same treatment from her? After all, there's something they say in Hausa language that she's actually Amaria. The broom that they use to flog the Uwankida, that's the first wife, right? Is the same broom they're going to use to flog the second wife. Don't make it sound as though it's like they tolerate domestic violence. No. It simply means when you see a man maltreating another woman, don't think that your own case is different. Do you understand that kind of thing? So that was what came to my mind. It means when I am in trouble, when I have my own issues, I'm going to get the same treatment that he's going to give that same lady. And then secondly, he said he had actually gone to see her people. We have this custom in Nigeria, before you marry, you go and see the ladies' people. Then they will do introduction, then they will give you lists, then you bring that will contain the bride price and everything. Then you come and pay the bride price on the day of the traditional marriage before you can proceed with any other thing. So he said he had gone to see her people and they had given him a list, and the list was too expensive for him. I was like, really? So the list is too expensive. Where is this lady from? That she's from Kaduna State. Okay, Kaduna is somewhere in northern Nigeria. It's northern. Basically, the people of Kaduna, I am from Plateau State in Nigeria. And the people from Kaduna and the people from Plateau are the same. You know, so many ethnic groups clamped together in one place. We have the same cultures, we have the same tradition, we believe on the same things. And I happen to know for a fact that one of the major ingredients for paying bride price for a lady from Kaduna is salt. So you don't want to pay salt and palm oil. You don't want to pay, I don't even know what it is, but me too, if you are going to marry me, I'm from Plateau State. The list of ingredients is going to be the same, or my own may even be costlier. So therefore, after you have stayed with a lady for 10 years, you have chased away suitors. Time to pay bride price now. You say it's too costly. Bride price in Kaduna is so therefore is bride price in Kaduna is too costly. Therefore, it's bride price in Plateau that is very, very cheap, right? Can I name her? I'm not the one that is going to come and cooperate with you to do that. Meanwhile, this guy that is talking is from Akwa Ibom State. They have some of the most costly bride price that they pay. You can literally have to buy keke napep or buy cars or buy gold walking stick and buy all this before you marry a lady from his place. So he's looking for cheap wife. Therefore, let him come to northern Nigeria. Let him come to the middle belt and pick Plateau or Kaduna girls, right? So that was the reason why I felt, man, this guy, you are not serious in this life. When you are serious, you will go and look for a beke like you. Dated the guy and went. And then he told me that in his attempt to push his vision, you know the way they say, then there was this thing they always say, and people still say now that we should marry a man with vision so that you will not watch the man with vision, or is it something about vision and television? So that when you marry a man with vision, you will not have to watch the man with vision on television. That's the way they say it, Jare. Anyway, so he was pitching his vision to me, which was that I shouldn't worry about the way he is right now. He knows that he's broke and he can't do this and he can't do that for me. But his vision, which he's calling me so that the Lord will call us together. I hate it when people try to use God's name to perpetrate fraud. He was just like, so you mean God did not see anybody in this world to send to me? It's you, he's sending. God is not serious. Like, God is going to give me a better man than that. But anyway, according to him, that so his vision is that he's going to be a big time tele-evangelist like Pastor Oyedepo. You know, Nigeria, we have a lot of big time mega pastors that are billionaires. So his own was that his vision is that he's going to be like all these mega pastors, but he needs a woman by his side like all these big pastors. And I fit the bill because, one, I'm studying law, therefore I'm going to know so many, you know, lawyers. Now we're going to add some more rep to him when he tells people his wife is a lawyer. And then according to him, I am eloquent. I don't know for you guys, am I really that eloquent? So I am eloquent, and I'm the kind of person who is going to hold microphone and address large crowds. Therefore, I'm the kind of woman that he wants by his side. And then secondly, he also loves me because I am very beautiful. I'm like, okay, so what exactly are you going to be adding to my life? I didn't ask him that anyway because I had already judged him that the content of his character was very poor. He didn't give me a cogent reason why he was breaking up with the other lady. She didn't do anything particularly bad. You know, that kind of thing. And you know, when somebody is telling you about his romantic history and doesn't take responsibility for anything, everything in that relationship is the fault of his ex, then something is wrong. And I knew that even back then, I was very immature, but I knew that him too, he should have taken responsibility for something, some of the things that happened in that relationship, and he did not. Therefore, so I just said, this one, he doesn't take responsibility. Two, he's looking for a very cheap woman. Three, I'm not interested in being a pastor's wife. Four, I'm not interested in struggling with somebody until he makes it big or something like that. You know, that kind of thing. So I politely told him no. But by the time I was saying that no, he had already started calling me honey and sweetheart and was telling everybody in the world that me and him were engaged. It took very, very serious intervention from me and my friends before that guy stopped spreading my name around, that kind of thing. And I was like, Pastor, you're not serious. A few years later, let's say about 2 or 3 years later, a friend of mine who were classmates had fallen into his trap, and the guy was his pastor. So one day he had told him that that there was a lady he wanted to marry who is a lawyer, but she didn't. And he said her name is Ajala. So the guy said he knows me now. And one day, by sheer coincidence, we were in the same place. I didn't know that the guy was standing behind me. So the guy, that friend of mine, came and told me, he said, do you know Pastor so and so? And I was like, no, that guy, you know, I just gave my opinion of him, which was very, very low. And it turned out that he was standing behind me. So he heard what I said about him. And then a few weeks later, he came and confronted me on Facebook and was saying that, why would I say that about him? And I said, sorry, that is just the way I thought of you and that kind of thing. Even back then, somebody had jilted me a few weeks before he came. And I decided that me as a person, let me put myself in the shoes of the other lady that he's dating, that he has jilted and now wanted to come and meet me. I don't want to ever be the one to contribute to a woman's pain. And I have said it in my life then. So then, while he was doing all these things, it was just strengthening my resolve that nothing in this life is ever going to make me here to be a reason why another woman like me will go to bed crying. And because of that resolve, I never dated a married man. I never knowingly dated a man who was in a relationship until today I got married and I got out of the dating scene. Do you have any story like mine of any composite bros there, you know, marrying for potential? And you know the thing with that, this guy, I met him a few years ago when I had two children. I was at the ATM trying to withdraw money and I saw him. The guy has not changed. So immediately I saw him, I was like, Ajala, you made the right decision. Sometimes, you know, you could maybe judge somebody wrongly, but I didn't judge this guy wrongly. I found out that I made the right decision not to marry him because I had two beautiful, adorable daughters, and he was telling me that up to now you've not even given your husband a son. What you have to go and be cooking water, giving him beans and watermelon and cabbage. That was going to ginger him to make you to have boys for him. What kind of nonsensical story is that? So had it been I was married to him, I am going to be the one to be jumping from pillar to post, or he'll be pestering me again to give him baby boy. Anyway, we just thank God for wisdom. I didn't know that I was even wise then, but thank you so much for listening to me. That was how I escaped that trap. And because of him, anybody that comes near me in the name of I am a pastor, or the Lord said this, or the Lord said that, I typically will not even answer you. As in, for example, Mabaka answered, but really, okay, no problem, let the Lord come and meet me and tell me. And me, I already have a covenant between me and the Lord, which is that, Lord, if you want to tell me anything, I'm not deaf, I'm not dumb, you created me in your image and likeness, come and tell me yourself, find a way to tell me. But I don't want charlatans to come to me with a message from God. I don't listen to people who say they have messages from God for me at all, especially from men. I've never admired myself being a mommy G.O. or anything like that. No offense to mommy G.O.s, but I will not call for that. We're all going to serve in different capacities in the Lord's vineyard. Thank you for staying with me till the end. I really appreciate it. And if you did up till now, please remember, like, comment, subscribe to the channel if you haven't. I'd really, really know your opinion on these kinds of stories, on dating potentials. And if you want to share your story of how you refuse to date or marry somebody, comment section is wide open. Even my inbox on Facebook, Ajala Upfront, is wide open. I will see you all in my next video. Have a nice day. Bye-bye.